As a series, Charmed falls short in many areas, but if there is one place where it does excel, it's characterization. This is never more evident than in the character arc and development of elder sister Prue Halliwell, who, during her tenure on the show, underwent incredible growth in three individual character arcs, all of which worked to turn her into one of the most interesting characters of the series. Today, we're going to take a look at Prue's arcs within the three seasons she was on the show and examine her development and overall characterization.
You're obsessing.
Well, it runs in the family.
I don't obsess. I think intensely.
Prue starts the series as a hardworking, responsible, and rigid character. Her dynamics with both her sisters are established early in the pilot episode, and we see that she is something of an authority figure to her younger siblings, berating Piper for missing an appointment and lecturing Phoebe regarding her irresponsible ways. She also demonstrates a maternal instinct by bringing Phoebe an extra blanket, even as she expresses displeasure and disapproval towards her.
She's always been more like a mother.
That's not her fault. She practically had to sacrifice her own childhood to help raise us.
Yeah.
Prue's air of authority may explain why the fandom has always been so ambivalent towards her. The original target demographic for Charmed was preteen and teenage girls, two age groups who do not always respond well to authority figures. This is reflected within the show with the episode The Fourth Sister, which introduces a young witch named Aviva who attempts to befriend the Charmed ones. Aviva takes an almost instant disliking to Prue while simultaneously bonding with Phoebe, someone who also struggles with Prue being an authority figure, and Aviva is a reflection of the audience's initial reactions to Prue and her characterization.
You didn't tell your bitch sister about this, did you?
Hey, watch your mouth. Prue had every right to be upset with what you did.
It's funny how you knew that I was talking about Prue and not Piper.
Learning to relinquish this authority and become a sister rather than a mother is a big part of Prue's arc in the first season. This is especially true of her relationship with Phoebe. When Phoebe first moves back into the manor, Prue is distrustful of her troublemaking younger sister and often treats Phoebe as if she is still a child, telling her off for her lack of responsibility and being quick to judge and blame her. This stems not only from Phoebe's own shortcomings, but from Prue not initially recognizing the change in her sister and still viewing her through a parental lens. Prue's judgmental attitude towards Phoebe does start to shift as the sisters become closer due to their supernatural destiny, also helped along by Phoebe's own growth and recognition of her personal flaws.
Hey, wait, that's it?
You're not gonna get mad at me?
You were trying to do something good. And now you're gonna get to do something wonderful.
Prue's evolving relationship with her sisters is not simply confined to her relinquishing her parental control. She also has to learn to open herself up and show her sisters affection and affirmations of her love. Season 1 Prue is initially a closed-off character, keeping her emotions close to the chest and unwilling to allow herself to be vulnerable, a result of her mother's untimely death. The Season 1 episode From Fear to Eternity is the first of three episodes which force Prue to confront the ongoing issues stemming from her grief and fear over her mother's demise. In the episode, it's revealed that Prue never tells her sisters outright that she loves them.
Whenever I say it to her, she says something like, oh, me too, or same here.
You know, you're right.
Yeah, the girl cannot say the words, I love you. It's like some weird...
Morning.
Oh, good morning.
Prue admits that the reason she never says the words is because the last person she said I love you to was her mother, right before Patty drowned. The episode explores the girl's greatest fears and initially presents Prue's greatest fear as drowning. However, it soon becomes clear that this actually masks her true fear of intimacy and vulnerability, and the demon of the week taps into this, rendering Prue powerless and almost killing her. It is only after confronting her fear head-on that Prue is able to save herself, and she finally opens up to her sisters, uttering the words she has been too afraid to say for 20 years.
What did you just say? I love you.
That's the first time you've ever said that to me.
Yeah, I know.
Another factor which plays into Prue opening herself up is her relationship with Andy Trudeau, a past boyfriend who unexpectedly comes back into her life at the same time she receives her powers. Andy provides Prue with a link to her past at a time when her future has become uncertain, and through their relationship, Prue becomes more vulnerable and emotional, especially with regards to expressing her feelings. Their relationship also forces Prue to become more honest and open as she is pushed to reveal her supernatural secret to Andy. Even though their relationship ultimately comes to an end, Prue takes an important step in trusting Andy with her secret, allowing herself to confide completely in another human being and not just rely on herself.
I'm glad I told you. I am.
So am I. Now when you need me, all you have to do is ask.
Andy's tragic death in the season finale sets up Prue's initial conflict for the next season and adds a layer of tragedy and vulnerability to her character. When the second season opens, Prue is still deeply grieving Andy and carrying around significant guilt over his death, both of which hinder her powers. She expresses a desire to turn her back on her powers and path as a witch, something which every sister does at some point in the series as their destinies encroach on their personal lives.
Andy died because of me. Okay, it doesn't matter what he said, it was my fault. How can it be good to be witches if all it does is get the people we love killed?
After confiding her guilt and fears in Andy's former partner Daryl and allowing herself to break down and draw strength from her sisters, Prue resolves to honor Andy's memory and move forward with her life. This opening episode shows how far Prue has already come from her hardened and closed-off persona of the first season. Whereas she previously would have dealt with this tragedy alone, pushing others away as we initially see her do in the episode, she has clearly learned to be more vulnerable and open, seeing her sisters as equals whom she can lean on, as opposed to children who must be shielded from her problems.
You like being a witch too much, Phoebe. And you help remind me that I like being one too.
While Prue's journey in season 1 was about her growing as a person and altering the dynamic between herself and her sisters, her journey in season 2 focuses more on her changing her external life and transitioning onto a new path, and she is helped in this by her two love interests of the season. She doesn't have long or particularly deep relationships with either of these men, adding to the idea that this season is one of transition and change. The writers of the show were smart enough to not rush Prue into another deep relationship and instead introduce Jack Sheridan, who was very clearly supposed to be a transition romance for her. Jack was younger, far more immature, and much less controlling and rigid than Prue, and he helped to open her back up to the possibility of romance and to a life that wasn't so structured. Season 2 sees Prue adjusting her controlling nature and learning to embrace the unknown, and Jack is a big part of that. His chaotic integration into her workplace also helps her to realize that she may want a different career path, and she makes a completely un-Prue-like move and quits her job, moving on from the stability of Bucklands while gently letting Jack go.
You have been great. You've opened me up to so many new things. Made me feel wanted again.
But
I need to be alone for a while. No strings.
In the episode Miss Hellfire, Prue goes undercover as a hitwoman hired to kill the Charmed Ones, and she meets Bane Jessup, a charismatic criminal whom she is instantly attracted to. Back in season 1, an episode saw Prue splitting herself into three personas, one of which was a wild, sexually charged rule breaker, and Miss Hellfire sees the return of this wild side to Prue Halliwell, a side we have not seen the last of.
Maybe I'm working.
More like you're working it. Come on, Prue, I've taken a walk on the dark side. I know all the signs.
Okay, so it's a little different.
And dangerous?
I can handle it.
While Bane's first appearance doesn't affect Prue all that much, his return later in the season comes at a crucial time in her life, just as she is embarking on a new career path as a professional photographer. A somewhat risky career choice, which shows how committed Prue is to changing her life and trying out new experiences, indulging in her dreams rather than her responsibilities. When Bane unexpectedly comes back into her life, Prue discovers that underneath the hardened criminal exterior, Bane is also a dreamer, someone with ambition and aspirations, and she finds herself deeply identifying with the uncertainty and loss of control which accompanies pursuing passion over stability. Prue's connection with Bane helps Bane face the consequences of his criminal actions, and his genuine gratitude towards her gives Prue the strength to continue on her chosen path.
Thank you for saving my life.
Thank you for changing mine.
As with season 1, season 2 dedicates an episode to Prue's ongoing trauma surrounding her mother's death. Where we previously saw her facing the fear of intimacy which stemmed from Patty's demise, season 2 has her face her fear of repeating her mother's life, in particular, her fear of dying young. In the episode P3H2O, the girls revisit the lake where their mother drowned and meet her former lover and white lighter Sam. While Piper and Phoebe express anger and resentment towards Sam for letting their mother die, Prue alleviates the white lighter's guilt, recognizing that Patty ultimately made her own decisions and her own choices which led to her death. Prue clearly sees those same choices reflected in herself, and while she faces and survives the demon who killed her mother, her issues with Patty's death are far from over, and her struggle with her past, her parents, and the possibility of an early death become big themes in her final arc on the show.
Because every single day I feel like I'm becoming more and more like her, and every day it terrifies me.
Prue.
But, I mean, don't you guys see it? Look at what happened to her, and then look at what's happening to me. No successful relationship with guys, being responsible for a family, and now because of this being charmed thing, the very real possibility of dying young, it's like history is repeating itself.
Prue's season 3 arc differs from her previous two. While the first two seasons saw Prue change dramatically as a character and a sister, in season 3, she does not undergo the same growth. Instead, her arc sees her addressing issues with her absent father, learning to accept her mother's death and by extension the possibility of her own death, and trying to figure out who she is now that her sisters are becoming more independent and don't rely on her as much. The season has both Piper and Phoebe wrapped up in their individual romances, leaving Prue adrift as she struggles with her newfound freedom. Having defined so much of her life by her role within her sisters' lives, Prue finds it difficult to allow herself to be free without the burden of such responsibility. This becomes such an internal struggle that it manifests itself magically, and she starts to astral project in her sleep, losing herself in a persona very similar to her Ms. Hellfire cover and her wild doppelganger from season 1. This persona resurfacing shows how much Prue longs for fun and adventure, but how she is held back by her own controlling and responsible nature, and this manifestation of her subconscious could also indicate guilt over her season 2 path, with Prue feeling that she has shirked her responsibilities and obligations by pursuing her passion and allowing herself to be less rigid. With the help of Phoebe, she learns that it's okay for her to have her own life and pursue her own desires, and that she doesn't have to worry about her sisters anymore because she has done such a good job of raising them.
Because we're okay now, Piper and May. We've both got passion and purpose in our lives, and you gave us that.
I did.
You took care of us. And now it's time to take care of you.
Season 3 also sees Prue confronting her past with the return of the girl's father, forcing her to address the issues she has surrounding his abandonment. After Patty died and Victor walked out, the girl's grandmother forced Prue into the role of a parent, and it is clear that Prue resents her father for the loss of her childhood. Unlike her sisters, Prue shows no desire to reconcile with Victor, and initially reverts to the closed-off coping mechanism which we saw in the first season and then again when Andy died. Despite her progress, Prue still struggles with allowing herself to be vulnerable, especially around someone who has hurt her so deeply.
If you're gonna go with the Prue's Got Parental Issues card, let me save you some time.
It is eventually revealed that the girl's grandmother is the one who drove Victor away, not believing that a mortal man was fit to raise three witches. And this revelation shakes Prue's belief in her grandmother as well as her resentment towards her father. When she is sucked into a magical otherworld, she places her trust in her father to save her, and he does, thus restoring some of her faith in him. And after he helps them defeat the demons of the week, we see a shift in Prue's attitude towards him. Over the season, Victor reappears several times, and Prue becomes warmer and more receptive to him, showing once again how much she has grown since the first season, and how she is more willing to be emotionally vulnerable and put her trust in others.
I'm not saying goodbye.
Prue.
I'm saying see you soon, Dad.
Thank you.
In keeping with confronting her past, Prue has a final episode in which she's forced to deal with the issues surrounding Patty's death, as she comes face to face with Death himself and has to harshly learn that he is not the enemy. In the episode Death Takes a Halliwell, Prue's anger and grief over her mother's death is laid completely bare, and her desperation to make death something she can physically fight and overcome is shown when she goes up against him, attempting to fight death even as her blows pass through him with no consequence. Her refusal to admit defeat and her desperation to save the innocent of the weak culminates at the end of the episode when she finally breaks down after Death bluntly tells her that he is simply a natural part of life. Prue's desperate sobbing at the end of the episode and Death's accurate assessment of her anger over Patty's death show her grief, guilt, and helplessness more intensely than previously seen on the show, as well as eerily foreshadowing her own early demise.
I've been mad at you for so long. Ever since Mom died, I don't know how else to be.
You grieve, and then you move on.
Prue Halliwell was a truly amazing character, and her presence was felt throughout the rest of the series run. Had external forces not forced Shannon Doherty off the show, there was no limit to the greatness Prue could have achieved. There was so much left to unpack with her character, especially with season 3 allowing her to be a more independent character, separating her from her sisters, and addressing many of her issues with her past. The 3 seasons we did have her for were honestly the best in the show's run, and her character development across the seasons was one of the best aspects of the series. There is a reason she still resonates with so many viewers, even now, so many years after her untimely death.